And against Hooney, whether they're blue side or red side, it's just he was one of the first ones to jump right back on to the Rumble pick, you know, with the proto belt, and plays it so aggressively. The other two obviously are the mid laners, and there's the Malzahar ban that we talked about as well for Phoenix One, so that's off the table. We shall see. Maybe they do go with that Cassiopeia. Definitely been a huge champion recently, pretty much across the world, actually, just because of the reliable backline damage and counter engage.
Yeah, but with Sivir open and so many other power picks, it seems like Phoenix One decide to commit to Karma.
And Karma has been extremely big in North America. However, Sivir is just pretty much the queen of AD carries right now, and it is fairly risky to give that over to Immortals. They have the option of first rounding it here. I don't see any reason not to go with it. It might be something like that plus the Rek'Sai, as all the junglers have been left up, and that's been Rainover's favorite. But Inori has definitely been willing to step outside of the normal jungle breakdown. But there you go. Those are the two obvious picks.
Mm-hmm. That's Sivir and Rek'Sai for Wild Turtle and Rainover. And of course, that Rek'Sai does rather well into Hecarim.
Ooh. Little bit of twist in the flavor there. Inori did have that legendary game on Hecarim. Plus, he had multiple, you know, Baron steals, Elder Dragon steals, pretty much a highlight reel on Hecarim. But I don't think that he'll be unhappy to play Rek'Sai, any jungler right now. It's a very easy champion to pick up, a very easy champion to play, and also extremely powerful. So, decide to go with, because, I mean, both teams do have some, a bit of extra speed for the team, and that is also going to, as everyone likes to point out, help out Hecarim, because he converts speed into damage.
Yeah, the big thing that I like when looking at Phoenix One right now is the fact that as we go down these player cams, everyone on the team is smiling. This is such a positive environment for these guys, and you can tell it's really having an amazing effect. They started 0-9.
See, it's the good. That's a good part about, you know, making a bunch of mistakes and losing a bunch of games early on. when you start winning, you feel great because you feel like, oh wow, we don't really, we haven't won before. we've been depressed for so long. This is great. Good thing got happening. Ho!
That's
we
can
gloss over this, though. Yeah. Kalista making a return as Mash decides to pick her up, possibly with the Trundle support, possibly Flex here. Karma very well could be moved down there as well, because Brandini's been the Trundle player for the team recently. For better or for worse, he's on that pick all day, every day.
Yeah, he had to play it against Seraph, I think, all three games yesterday. Yeah. And by the end of game three, he was actually showing, hey, I know how to play this matchup, and I can do rather well if I manage to get ahead. But pressure is on. We'll see if he can do it once again. Hooney, very talented top laner. Sonra, again, locked in for Adrian. She's been looking rather strong, but Phoenix looking for their final two picks.
Yeah, and the Lissandra as well making a resurgence. I'm very excited about this champion select, actually, because we get some new flavor, you know, some mix-up in the meta that we've been seeing teams fall into in the last couple of weeks in North America. You know, now there's extra hard engage. When you already see a Sivir Hecarim, you think, okay, this team's looking to dive. Maybe they'll have a dive buddy for Hecarim, Shen, or something like that. But Lissandra's going to get right in there. Hard lockdown.
Oh, no.
Hey, we thought it was just the Kalista. Just getting started here. Mordekaiser.
Oh, my.
Please
goodness.
Tell me that was not a misclick. It looks like they're just going as planned.
They're holding on to it. Coach and ref aren't turning their heads or anything. Big
the classic combo here. Mordekaiser with Taric. Boop, boop. Get the stun. The dragons as well. Honestly, though, let's take a look at this strategy that P1 are going for. Because at first we thought, okay, it's just an interesting wrinkle. Yeah, they want to play Kalista. But Kalista provides a lot of neutral objective control. Great at securing dragons and barons alike. Mordekaiser puts more benefit on getting dragons. And the bottom lane here, which is going to be the Taric and the Kalista, as you know, all the flex picks have been filtered out to top lane Trundle and mid Karma, is going to provide a decent amount of control down there as well. Wait a second. Never mind. Trundle might be jungle. Mordekaiser might be jungle.
That's a lot
it's
of
still
flex.
Flexible. It's still flexible. I mean, they can still switch it around. I say that it's top lane Trundle and mid lane Karma, but it's still movable. Inori,
oh, wow.
I have to say, though, definitely my favorite player in the LCS right now. All LCS.
Breaking out the Rengar, breaking out the carry Hecarim, and now he's going to do it again with Mordekaiser. So this is the first Mordekaiser in the LCS this split.
It is. Interesting little fact right now, in Platinum and above, in the previous patch, Mordekaiser was the highest win rate jungler.
Yeah. in 614.
Which is the patch that we're playing on in LCS, but with a very, very small play rate. So those types of numbers get kind of wonky when you have really small play rate champions like that, because of the sample size. But if I do my research here really quick, the recommended build has been the Rylai's into the Zerat portal. Let's get ready to rumble!
Just get dragons in there. Oh yeah, this is going to be great. But we want to know what you think. Do you think Phoenix One has it in them to take down Immortals? Let us know on Twitter. Post with hashtag P1Win or hashtag IMTWin as we load onto the Rift. Can Inori do it again, or will Immortals shut him down? You gotta give a lot of credit to Phoenix One. This is awesome.
Yes, you definitely do. Credit for awesomeness so far in Champion Select due to Phoenix One. We'll see. Yeah, Runic Echoes into Lucidity Boots, Rylai's.
Woo!
Have been the go-to. Let's see what he can get done with it.
This is so cool.
I mean,
I just want to watch what they do with this.
Yeah, it's not a surprising champion. I mean, it's surprising that he gets picked, but he doesn't pull off surprise plays in the game. So it should be fairly predictable as he just tries to grind out his jungle path. I mean, everybody always likes to play weird champions in, you know, ranked play or solo queue or normal game. Whoa, they're actually going to for a bush.
Adrian, why? One bonk,
Derek,
two bonk, three bonk. Four! First blood, Phoenix One!
Oh my god, they didn't give it to Mordekaiser, but still, holy moly, he's off to the races already! Phoenix One with the genius draft here to guarantee first blood, Dom.
All according to plan.
Yeah, they knew it. They're like, oh, we'll pick Mordekaiser. Adrian will just face check our bush when we've got the Terra Callista ready. Oh. Perfect for chasing down anyone. And that is the way you want to start the game when you've got a jungle Mordekaiser on your team.
Oh,
speaking of ranked play, that's just one of the times where you're like, oh my god, my team is trolling. You know, everybody's picking these random champions, but you're like, whatever, I'm not dodging. We'll play it out anyway. And then things start to go your way. Like, oh, sweet, we're winning. Nice.
This is the the one Mordekaiser one trick that you run into in ranked. Oh boy, this is stellar. I love what's going on here. Alrighty, so 500 gold advantage. Looks like we're not going to be seeing lane swaps as Mash and Gate start off with that Krug camp on the bottom, and Inori gets a bit of a leash here.
I love it. They can't make it into playoffs and stuff, you know, might as well try something and, you know, get famous. He's the Mordekaiser jungler now.
I mean, they've definitely got some street cred.
Oh yeah.
Breaking out the Rengar and the Mordekaiser. And this has to be at least two games in this set. The set is young. Mash is going really hard. That's a very early exhaust.
Yeah, they got first blood, so they had extra experience, even though the experience you get for early kills was greatly reduced. So it wasn't that big of a difference. Did get level two first, trying to push down here on them and keep control of the minion wave. That's so important when you're playing against Sivir. It's always about the control of the minion wave. The other thing is that Callista, when she was in the meta, was picked into Sivir very often because it's really hard to spell shield Callista damage, and Callista is such a good lane bully versus the Sivir. It's just that she's been out of the meta for so long, kind of fell out of your thought process, right, in Champion Select. But here we go. Mash is trying to make the old lane counter work out. Hard versus a Sona, though, in the current state, because there's a lot of healing. Here we go with some jungle action, though.
Oh, I don't think Inori saw him. Rainover getting a sneak gank on that bottom lane. That's four summoners. He ghosts. There goes Mash. He sees it now. Oh, he gets pulled back, holding onto the flash. There he goes. Gate in the back. Not actually burning it just yet. And Phoenix One walk away.
Yeah, they did have to burn both summoners off the AD carry.
Yeah, he did heal.
And Mordekaiser might slip in here for some lane minions. Nope. The duo's gonna stay, and Adrian
Not again! Oh, he's got the Rend building up. That's one more bonk to heal.
throw. No.
The flash bonk from Minori.
It was only the two bonk, not the three. Oh, boy.
It's a red buff on him. It's like, yeah, let's go.
And your Adrian was like, I don't want any part of this.
If it was a jungler with any sort of CC, then yeah, they probably could have picked up that kill too. But Mordekaiser, you just wait till he gets level 6, though. You just wait until they get dragon control and you see the dragon ghost coming through.
As soon as he gets Rylai's, he'll have all the crowd control he needs.
Yeah, because, I mean, we're joking about this pick a lot, but there are actual strategies to talk about with Mordekaiser. Most of them do revolve around, the dragon, but they're also a lot about, you know, mid-game power spikes, which is where Kalista shines. You know, the 1 and 2 items for Kalista are huge. Karma as a mid laner also spikes very early, and Trundle can become viable super early on as well. Depends on what build the Trundle does want to go with. If Brandini wants to go split push again, or if he actually does want to, you know, try and team fight. I would suggest that he does go the split push to try and pull people away from the dragon so that the rest of P1 can take that dragon and really start to use the Mordekaiser snowball, get the ghost, and start knocking down turrets.
Yeah, and that is the Infernal Drake first, so very high priority for both of these teams to try to secure that early on. As it is, though, we're seeing the junglers just clear out, go for some of those early backs. Jungle Potion picked up now for Rainover. He's going to be healing up and sustaining as much as possible. Gabe stops the recall. Unfortunately, that's not a projectile, so it goes through units.
That was a really good delay, though. I mean, every time you can delay a recall like that, if you have control of the minion wave as well, it actually makes them decide to stay in the lane, and the fearsome, flashless Mordekaiser gets another kill!
Oh my gosh! Inori gets one. Teleport. He's got the pillar, but no, it is going to be canceled. There's a ghost. They're turning it back around. Uh-oh, Victor trying to catch up. Snare. Uni actually completed his mash. He's caught out on the side by Poe Belter. And there's Brandini now joining in. The Phoenix one trying to turn it around. The Gale one. Rainover has got to run. He gets out of the pillar. And the slow, but will escape with his life.
Oh, Period actually get us some alone time with Poe Belter.
Oh my gosh, we flashed over. Period knows no limits.
Well, Rainover's gonna chase him off, and that might be the Drake we talked about.
Oh yeah.
Here we go.
Oh, and Inori's level 6 now.
Prepare for the ghost. See what they can get with it, because you immediately want to try and get some turret gold once you get this ghost. The pushing power is insane. It just takes so long to kill the actual dragon because it has so much health that you can use it to tank the turret and damage it the whole time. People are getting amped up, baby. We're seeing that. Look at this Mordekaiser gang. Oh, one auto. One auto. All right. And then finished it off there with the W.
There's the late teleport from Brandini. Seraph did teleport in from the bottom. We let Phoenix 1 get split up. But the Mordekaiser.
Yeah, I mean, this was the teleport from Brandini. Did get the bite on Mash before, on Sivir before the flash went off, so that the attack will continue unless you flash into Fog of War. Any sort of those melee things will complete, even if the person flashes away.
Mm-hmm. So, 7 minutes in, and Phoenix 1 are leading over Immortals by about 1,200 gold. They've already secured the first Infernal Drake, and now they've swapped their duo to the top lane, and the crowd is with Phoenix 1!
The Giant Killers, Phoenix 1! I gotta say, I was pretty slow this morning. Took a long time to get up, trying to get ready. I thought it was gonna be a rough day, but I'm amped up now. This is exciting. Super, super fun game.
Yep.
We'll see what they can actually do, because I'm very disappointed in the dragon use. We were talking up the dragon use for Mordekaiser for
so
long.
And then he recalls,
He recalls and he does like 3 jungle camps with it.
That's okay. Dragon's coming up in another few minutes, so we'll see if he can take advantage of that. Phoenix 1 now rotate towards the mid lane. They were spotted out by a ward, though.
Yeah, D2 is way better than D1 anyway. We'll see what they can do with D2, because that's when Mash is going to start completing an item. You know, they'll have a little bit more pressure in all of their laning champions as well. Talked about the mid-game power spikes for this team. That's where they're really going to try and push it.
Mm-hmm.
They don't want to let the late-game Sivir come to fruition.
Oh, no.
They're trying to end it before that.
Timer is ticking for Phoenix One, but they've already got TSM in their trophy case. Can they add Immortals to it as well? They've definitely got the surprise factor in this game. But again, this is a best of three. If they win this one, they'll still have to take another. And the pressure is on. However, for the time being, they are content to keep these lanes nice and safe, knowing that there's no Drake for a while with the duo top. Just gives them some pressure on the Rift Herald. Brandini is nice and safe down in that bottom tier one.
Yeah, I mean, he's going to take a beating as Trundle in that matchup as far as CS goes. Plus, he did the teleport to leave, so Huni got some extra ones there. Now he's made it to that cowl, though. I mean, the cowl is so important versus any melee top laner. Any ranged AP top laner for the melee top laners, because you really need that extra health regen and the magic resist to try and just sustain in lane. Having swapped down there, Huni's going for roams as well on the Sandra. But man, Mashing Gate really retaining control of that lane versus the Sivir Sona.
Yeah, they've actually got a CS lead right now, and we'll see if Wild Turtle will be able to catch up as he clears it out. Only down about five, so it's one minion wave.
Yep.
Spell shield early. Oh,
that's the difficulties of the Sivir and Kalista matchup. You kind of have to predict when the rend is coming out. All right, here's the difficulties of Mordekaiser jungle. You got to walk through wards. This means you won't get the kill, but you will get the objective.
Oh, yeah. That top tier one turret is not long for this world. Pobelter's on his way up there. He's got Ghost, and there's no ward in that bush as they thought to try to rush through.
Well,
and they will back away.
Yeah. I mean, they didn't. They just cleared that out in the tri-bush. Pink ward down there. Four immortals now in the tri-bush. And Rainover and Pobelter were returned to their previous duties, farming up. As Zenora was able to get a decent amount of damage on that turret with his little Sojourn up to the top side.
So far, he's keeping pace with Brainover, only down about 8 to 10 jungle camps. But for the time being, Rainover is just relegated to running around, trying to keep pace of this Mordekaiser. Get to the lane before Mordekaiser does.
Yeah, I mean, he's just trying to farm up till that Trinity Force.
Oh, yeah.
When you really start to feel the power on Hecarim. Is over a ward, though, that Anora just dropped on his last little route through mid and finds it with his Raptor proc here.
Mm-hmm. Drake now going to spawn in the next minute and a half. You can see Anori is trying to cheat down to this side. Seraph just completed a recall. If he can... Oh, no, he's just going to try to shove the turret.
Yeah, I mean, I like Anora is playing this Mordekaiser. He just farms his whole jungle out and then goes to the lane for a little while to get a couple hits on the turret. While he has no camps to farm, and then, you know, rinse and repeat back to the other side, because the ganks, as we said, they're not all that spectacular as far as crowd control you can bring. You're just a melee, slow melee champion at that, walking up, unless the enemy team is forced to fight you with something like the Taric and Kalista lane, where there's a bunch of CC in the lane there for you, then he's just providing a little bit of extra DPS. Starting to farm up, though. We'll see that build come out. He got two of the last hits, so a decent amount of early gold. Another swap here from P1 as they move their duo down bottom, trying to keep Huni walking around and trading lanes versus Brandini. Also, P1, since their duo lane has control of the wave versus the Sivir and Sona, they've been pushing it up first, you know, try and gain a little bit of tempo each time they swap the lane. Whoever's answering always loses out on a little bit of time with those minions.
And Nori chasing Rainover back. You can see that Ocean Drake has spawned, and there are four members of Phoenix One there. Brandini, as you said, with the tempo advantage, pressuring the turret. Teleport available for both.
The much-anticipated release of D2 coming out. Who's going to get the steal here? Oh, Rainover doesn't have smite. He can't steal it. No smite.
Yeah, meanwhile, that's the pull. Will he be able to get the stun follow-up?
Oh,
there's a huge
crescendo.
There's the Drake. Cosmic Radiance teleport is canceled, in fact. Brandini did join in that fight, so Seraph will try to answer back.
Yeah, I mean, Taric's... Whoa, they actually have Wild Turtle cut off here.
Ooh, that's not a good place for a Sivir to be. She flashes, still with her heal. The Drake is taking the turret, though. It's doing a lot of damage, and Wild Turtle goes down. Rainover in the back finds Pyrian, but he also falls, and Phoenix One take two kills.
And look at that dragon take the turret. That's what we're talking about. He can just stay there as long as he wants. They go behind Huni with no teleport here. I think he just used it previously to get back to lane because he's left up there all by himself. Brandini was able to come down, cut off Wild Turtle, and secure that kill, as it was not just the dragon they were going to take, but turret trade after. They also were able to get two kills to their names, and Phoenix One are actually controlling the early game versus Immortals.
Oh my goodness. If you could have heard yourself in week one, would you have believed?
No, of course not. I mean, maybe after the game where they were able to beat TSM and people are like, haha, okay, yeah, maybe they can take Immortals also. Yes, haha, they can.
Oh boy. All right, so Huni's able to trade back though, take that top tier one. It's still 2-1 in favor of turrets, but here's that again.
Yeah. I mean, I wasn't paying attention to Wild Turtle during the dragon because I was looking at P1 as they were moving up towards the blue buff, as you know, probably most other people were as well. And Immortals were disengaging there, rightfully so, because the Terra Cult came down, and there's no way that P1 can force that engage. But somehow Turtle wandered off down into the little corner there, and Brandini was able to make the cutoff. So,
you know, if I had to guess, I think he wanted to try to clear the minion wave so they couldn't collapse and take the turret. But Mordekaiser has a dragon.
I guess, yeah, and it, well. Bamboozled! Bamboozled here!
Absolutely flabbergasted by what's going on in this. 15 minutes in, and as you said, Phoenix One are controlling the early game against Immortals. 3,000 gold, and trying to speed things up.
I love it. I mean, you got to shake things up and go with the unexpected versus these teams. That's what people always complain about. Whenever we have the interviews with people like Doublelift after they lose to one of the bottom teams, which for him, which happens very often for them, actually. There's always this surprise loss to one of the bottom teams. He's always like, oh my god, I never expect them to do that because it's so ridiculous, yeah. Right? They're catching them off guard with so many different pieces here. Mash me with the Kalista lane, the very old lane into Sivir working out, getting control with the duo, plus the... Uh-oh, now they're going to get dove, and Rainover is on the way. He ghosted, so he's going to continue with that, but Pobelter.
Yeah, they're trying to get onto Pobelter in the mid lane. Pyrian is locked down, and Inori can't get in. The Cosmic Radiance wears off. Stun is countered by Stun, and Mash gets pulled to safety.
They escape, but Pyrian went down in the mid lane, and they didn't finish off Pobelter. No, the damage over time's not that big. You haven't seen that in a while, have you? Oh, what does that little ghost thing do? Maybe it explodes at the end. Yeah, the damage over time is not that big with it. And anyways, really what matters is the objectives afterwards. If we regain focus on this game, Immortals are trying to retake control. They focus on the bottom lane, go with the gank, even though it was unsuccessful, still get the turret down there and defended mid, plus got the counter kill on the P1 focus.
Oh, man. The young Mordekaiser gank. Walk through the minions and head on out. Hashtag P1 win. 17 minutes in and Phoenix One are trying to control this game. Pressuring quite a bit.
That's definitely how you get fan support. Mordekaiser, bring Kalista back in there. Take him into the jungle. I mean, he's going to be able to finish Rylai's, which I assume is going to be the next item, you know. You need some sort of crowd control to force these peons to fight you.
Stop running, let me kill you.
Yeah. Best skin, by the way, the King Mordekaiser there. All right, let's see if Phoenix One can actually close in and try and pressure mid, because they had four people around it. Yeah. Here's what happened in the early stages, though, is the two solo laners, double AP there from Immortals, bursting them down. There's the bottom action that we saw as well, as they were able to escape.
Mm-hmm. All righty, so we're continuing to watch Phoenix One pressure forward and try to invade those jungle camps. Inori is so close to finishing off that Rhinelize. He's got all the core components, and he's still, even in CS, while being 2-0-4, he's been involved in all of his team's kills, and so has Gate.
I have to say, the first couple of Mordekaiser ganks were hilarious as well. Not really the enabler for those, but definitely a participant. Here we go, though. Fight over pink wards.
And Ori's going in. Oh, man.
Ori's going out.
All right, that Ocean Drake is up in 30 seconds. That's why we see this skirmishing around the mid lane. The Mace of Spades. Inori doing what he can. Or no, that's clubs. I never understood why it wasn't the Mace of Spades.
Oh. I mean, that's what his Q is called.
the Mace of Spades.
Oh, so we can't have a skin named after his ability, maybe?
That's too confusing, Dom. Yeah.
Okay, Ocean Drake is up. And Immortals are there.
I don't know. D3 on release was pretty terrible.
All right, teleport from Huni. No answer yet from Brandini. They're already trying to burn it down. There goes some damage with the Chaos Storm. Seraph goes right onto Inori. He's locked down and separated from the team without Inori. That's the Drake secured. And Cosmic Radiance, no, doesn't proc in time. Immortals continue to chase.
Brandini is still coming? Oh, he is still coming.
He's trying to do some work, though. Gets the gravity field. Wild Turtle flashes away from Piri, and Brandini is not stopping. The split push Trundle.
Oh, he's
going
coming,
1v5. Gets a double kill. Piri kites it back right over. Oh, survives.
So Brandini started his teleport, but half of his team was dead by the time it finished. So a little bit late there for P1 as far as the coordination. And that is something that they have had trouble with before, you know, coordinating the teleports with the top laner, especially with a new longer channel. It's definitely something that is a reoccurring problem for them. They're going to want to clean this. But look at this. They're fighting. They're forcing this dragon. And now the teleport starts channeling. Inor is already dead before he even shows up down there. They're chasing down the rest of the team. The dragon's already dead. Gate's gonna get popped here really quick. And now he's trailing into the teamfight. I actually thought he was gonna pull off, but they salvaged a little bit of the situation as he goes for Adrian first. Turtle gets hit with the Q as well from Pyrian to add a little bit of damage, and Brandini's gonna finish him off. So they salvaged a couple of kills, but it could have gone quite a bit better for them, I believe.
Yeah. I think the most telling thing was watching Immortals move as a unit. Reignover, Huni, and Adrian all acted at the exact same time, splitting Phoenix One up, where the surprise factor couldn't really take effect. Phoenix One just didn't quite have the opportunity to respond, so Immortals still demonstrating they've got the patience, they've got the technical skill to be able to play this out, but with that first Drake for themselves, that's going to help out quite a bit. The next one will be Infernal, as the Rylai's has been finished now for Inori. Finally, he can chase some people down.
Yeah, he's got his Rylai's. Mash is about to complete Blade of the Ruin King, so he'll have that two-item power spike for Kalista. And that would be where, you know, Phoenix One have to make their move, because if they give Immortals much more time than that, it's gonna get worse and worse for them as it goes on. But, you know, what they want to do is be able to force the fight and then keep Immortals in the 5-on-5 with the Trundle Pillar spam, the Kalista Wrens, and the Taric stuns. If they can keep them in the 5-on-5 when Taric ult does go off, then should be able to, you know, get that first kill, get the ghost, and start snowballing.
Yeah, Brandini slip pushing on the far side. Again, trying to pull the attention of Immortals apart. You saw Reignover heading over before coming back to the mid lane. He's not going to fall for that just yet, so that means that Brandini can continue to shove. Still down about 30 CS, but he's 3-0-2. Definitely keeping pace.
Yeah, and he is going for the Ravenous split push build there. Early Spirit Visage is the way to go versus that double AP team. See if Phoenix One can correct after that last little hiccup over Dragon number 3. They gave over the extra ocean. The extra ocean, not that big a deal, but they would love to be stacking these drakes because having that extra pressure as you get towards the late game does help out a lot. Right now, a bunch of their vision has been transferred over to the Baron side of the map, though, as you can see all four of those pink wards. So they're going to try and set something up over there. Hope that Immortals will come and funnel into this P1 comp because they don't have a lot of utility. And if Turtle pops that Sivir ult, it's going to be pretty hard to lock down Immortals.
Ooh. And that's where you see how squishy that Mordekaiser is. Really need a team in front of him.
Yeah, it doesn't have any armor right now. You know, just the Merc Treads is only defensive and then a bit of health. So even though it's early for Wild Turtle and he's down on CS, Baron plus Boomerang still hurts.
Yeah. Now we can see Phoenix One continuing to play around that side of the map. 2 minutes for that Drake, but Phoenix One might get flanked here. Reignover over the wall, decides not to go in as he's spotted by a ward in that tri-bush, and there goes Inori. He's also going to be spotted out by a ward in the river. So Immortals know that this is happening.
Let's see what they do. Everybody's Reignover's baiting. Off.
They know they're in there. There goes the stun against Reignover. He gets a lot of damage. There's a huge crescendo. Reignover gets chased down and killed. And Brandini even teleports in as well. Wait, that's the jungler. And Huni actually follows up for Flashing Way.
Brain overtook that bait, hook, line, and sinker. Surprise Bush with the Taric Mordekaiser, locks him down. Now they've got the Horse Ghost.
Oh my god.
Gonna try and take down this turret afterwards. Get him, Rainover!
Yeah, continues to team phase kill. Forward. It's 6 versus 4 right now as Phoenix One are trying to break down this tier 2. And they will
fire
get it.
On.
Yeah. Clearing out the vision of Immortals now. Still 7 seconds before Rainover respawns as Phoenix One set up the bait and Immortals take it.
It's exactly what we were talking about, though. That's how you have to set it up when you're with Mordekaiser. You kind of need Immortals to charge into you. Gate, actually. Speaking of being in the wrong area.
That's a Chaos Storm. He actually flashes. Mash still has the ult. No, he doesn't, actually. Pobelter locks it down.
Now that is the incorrect way to bait. Here we go, though. Convergence on mid lane. As P1 should be able to defend it.
Yeah,
and they do see Wild Turtle off on the side, but still pretty risky here.
Yeah, that Infernal Drake is up in 12 seconds, but so too is Gate. He's going to have to haul all the way back. Bobelter eats some slows. Brandini, so fast. Can't quite catch up, though, as Immortals trying to fall back towards that river. They know that that's the objective, but Phoenix One feign towards the Baron.
A lot of pings over towards that Baron, and Immortals kind of have to respect it because there's a pink ward on the actual Baron pit. Pink ward's leading up to it as well. Once again, if you want to try that strategy where they force you to come into Mordekaiser. Oh, pings down on the Baron because Mash is on the Drake.
There's no vision for Phoenix One, however, so this is going to be taken. So the wave gets cleared out. Phoenix One grouped as 5 in the mid lane. Infernal Drake picked up. Immortals bring it right back to even in those neutral objectives.
Farming up for later as well. Wild Turtle now on 2 item Sivir. Infinity Edge comes in, and that's when the teamfight of Immortals gets extremely scary.
This is starting to become a pretty big Immortals team, and now that they're no longer falling for these baits, it's becoming more and more difficult for Phoenix One to take advantages. They're looking for wards around the map, looking to clear out the vision of Immortals, but the pressure is on. Brandini, no teleport for a little while, means he's going to be split pushing on the opposite side. Huni will have to catch him. Phoenix One try to keep clearing out this vision and defend their mid tier 1 turret.
Yeah, Brandini doesn't have teleport either, so this is he's gonna be over there split pushing by himself for a while as Phoenix One are trying to split the map here. Thing is here for Immortals, Turtle can go clear waves so quickly. You can see he's shoving out topside just as fast right now with the Sivir, and that's gonna be a big wave on top for Immortals. So with Huni catching bottom, they might actually be the ones trying to keep Phoenix One out in the open.
Killer slow on to Huni and a snare prevents Brandini from catching up. Ooh, gets a good jump, but he's taking a lot of damage here as Huni gets the better of this one. X-Tech Gunblade slows him down. Brandini slowly being whittled down.
Yeah, not a big deal though for Ravenous Trundle. That's the benefits of getting the early Spirit Visage plus Lifesteal. Plus laying down the Frozen Domain, heals right back up to full on a single minion wave.
Yeah, taking a look at the CS though as a result of this, it's actually even now in that top lane as that early game has reset in the jungle, still dead even. Pobelter has an advantage over Pyrion, but Mash is opening up an advantage over Turtle, so it's still very close in this game despite the gold difference on top of the screen.
Power play for Phoenix One on the top side of the map as well as they go down through the jungle here. Red side, they might be able to catch Adrian off guard.
Oh, Flash dodges the stun, but Inori chases the slow lands, but he doesn't quite have enough follow-up. Mash is on the wrong side of this.
Flash off of Sona is quite big, actually, though. Adrian, not only can he not reposition in the next team fight, but no exhaust and can't flash crescendo for Immortals. Pretty good flank right there as Inori and Gate took 2 separate angles with the Taric stun lining up, and Adrian had to push all the panic buttons to get out.
Immortals now trying to play defensive and not let themselves get picked off by that surprise. Wait, Mordekaiser?
Whoa.
That's the sound I assume he makes.
Yeah, look at the vision control that Phoenix One have. That's the most impressive part to me because Immortals are rarely, our teams that so rarely don't have map control, since they get these early leads so often and they, you know, start fighting over and over and over. They're actually in a rare position where they have to check this Fog of War, and you can see trying to put the wards down here into Baron, but Pink Ward's still standing for Phoenix One. They almost immediately clear them all out.
Yeah, such a dangerous position for Immortals if they get picked off. Brandini now with his teleport. Huni also has his own. Continuing to remain occupied in that bottom lane, shoving the tier 2 over and over.
Yeah, and remember, this shove is all about setting up for the neutral objectives. We talked about in Champion Select where the Kalista plus Mordekaiser is so much about those neutral objective control. And trying to retain this vision control so that the enemy team will walk into your Taric and into your consecutive slows of Mordekaiser and Trundle and Kalista as well. But there you go, Immortals. They make a pretty good incision right there into the vision.
Yeah.
The vision incision by Immortals right into the Baron.
Did you just make yourself laugh with that?
I'm having a weird day here, Dom.
This is not a dream. This Mordekaiser is actually happening. And Immortals are dealing with it rather well. I mean, despite the early advantage in control, they're able to retain vision. They're not face checking anymore, unless they know that they can do it as a unit. And that slowed things down quite a bit for Phoenix One. Not too much action since blowing that Sona Splash, and it's already two-thirds of the way up.
Yeah, you talk about the lack of action here. I would really, I mean, even though it's difficult for P1 because, you know, they don't really have the go button. It is all about how you control the vision around these objectives and how you get the side lanes to push up and try and force Immortals' hands. But I think we said, Turtle is getting closer and closer to that infinity edge for Sivir. And here we go. It's actually Immortals setting up.
There goes the Claw to try zoning away. Wild Turtle gets onto the turret, but the minion wave is cleared. It just takes a few hits.
Yeah, Nori actually got chunked out pretty heavily there as well. Luckily for them, though, Immortals pull back as both side waves are pushing in Phoenix 1's favor. Ooh, Brandini, 1 versus 2, go for the steal!
Oh, wow, that's going to be picked up by Pobelter, but Brandini has got to be careful. Huni clicks himself!
That was most definitely a misclick. Their models were right next to each other. He flashed right next to him. The flash self-ult, unlucky there for Huni.
Phoenix 1 pressuring that mid-tier 1 turret, seeing the jungle of Pobelter and Huni. They get some great chip damage onto the mid-tier 1, but it's still up.
That's the nerve showing versus the giant killers, Phoenix 1. Gotta be scared, you know. Don't want to fall to them as well.
Nope. 9-7, and Immortals are looking to not make the same mistakes as TSM. Try to lock this down, clearing out the vision, slowly getting the minions onto the turret, but they've gotta be so careful.
Yeah, look at those beautiful crits coming through from the Sivir ricochets.
Yeah.
Phoenix One, though, they move from Pink Ward Bush to Pink Ward Bush, trying again to set up one of these counter-initiation plays. Drake should go down pretty quickly.
That's 5 members of Phoenix One in the pit. They secure it. There goes the Cosmic Radiance. It's about to land right in time. Pyrion's on the side, but that's so much invulnerability as Phoenix One resets. Gate knocks out Huni. Brandini in the front. And Ori gets onto Rainover. He's going to try to kill him. He flashes, and that's the kill. Huni also falls, and Phoenix Water chasing forward. There's a chilling smite. Wild Turtle has died, and Phoenix Water doing it. They're winning the fight against Immortals.
Talked about it for so long. They got the neutral objective setup fight. They baited Immortals in. Immortals went in at the worst possible time, right after the Drake was taken. So Dragon Ghost was hitting them the whole time. Inori then was able to ult Wild Turtle. He turned it into the Sivir Ghost, which is the most powerful of the ghosts.
Oh, God.
And now Turtle's zoning him off the Baron. That should be Baron as well.
Oh, wow. Lots of damage. That's Wild Turtle going low.
Or should it?
Inori has no smite.
Pobelter could get the magical steal here with Victor if he can get a combo.
They're trying to stall it out. Brandini zoning on the side. Drops his subjugate to scare Pobelter back, but the Baron is being cleaned up by Gaiden Inori.
Great zoning right there. That is the biggest problem that we see from teams as you get to this stage, is they won't send people to go zone. Even if there's only a couple people on the enemy team, the possibility of stealing is very low. You gotta have people, you know, go interfere, because that is a heartbreaker if it gets stolen. Anyways, there it is. Rainover got in just after the Drake was killed. So the Dragon Ghost is up. Even though it gets killed pretty quickly here, Inori is going to get his ult on Wild Turtle right after this. There it is on Turtle, and he's right next to him, next to the pillar. Slows him down with the smite. Boop, there we go.
Oh my God.
Okay, so the ghost actually didn't do a whole lot in the fight, but was able to throw him off the Baron for a little bit here. I have to say, Phoenix One coming out of the gate swinging. And nobody knows what's going on. They're like, all right, refocus here. We'll get an update on what the problem is. But man, what a way to end the day here.
Yeah.
On Saturday night.
To start this series, Phoenix One, this is their last set in the summer split. And because they are locked into that promotion tournament, what better way than to go out with, I don't want to say a bang, this is like an explosion.
Yeah. I mean, how... It's just the most exciting team right now. Everybody loves underdog stories, right?
Yeah.
So they lost the first, nine series.
Yeah.
They are the underdogs of the North American LCS here. And such a strong resurgence in the second half of the split is just always fun. Everybody loves to get behind, bad news bears stories like that. And they're doing it in such a fashionable way with the Rengar picks, the legendary 13-0 Hecarim games, and the Mordekaiser jungle as well. It's just,
It is fantastic.
Great stuff from these guys mixing it up.
Quick update on the pause. Immortals are having some frame rate issues, so we're taking a look at that to see if we can get it fixed as quickly as possible.
The classic.
Yeah.
We're losing to Mordekaiser jungle. Lag.
Slash remake is only for the first 3 minutes, guys. But we'll see if we can get this resolved as quickly as possible. Maybe it was like, the Sivir shouldn't be attacking me. That's not normal. I didn't know friendly fire was in League.
Yeah, we need to take a look at this game, though, because it's actually going according to plan here for Phoenix One. Even though they had a bumpy, around the 20-minute mark, they started to lose a bit of control back to Immortals as Immortals were making some power plays. They've retaken control in a very big way here with this last bait around Dragon, where they got the Drake. They also got the team fight afterwards. And then we're able to get the Baron. That's a feels good, man. my face win. First person to pick Kalista in a long time. Plus, we're winning in Mordekaiser jungle.
Yeah, this is the second Kalista in the NALCS this split.
Yeah. Remember, though, because Immortals are running a team, they have Viktor and Sivir. So much wave cleared. On top of that, they also have Lissandra, who doesn't have terrible wave cleared on the side lane either. So there are a lot of options for stalling for Immortals here. While everyone's getting hyped up, this underdog story, Phoenix One, you want to see them also beat the other top team in North America. Immortals very much still in this game, and they can try and huddle down at their turrets and try and wave clear. The breaker is going to come from those Drake ghosts, right? The Mordekaiser ghosts. You can't wave clear that thing. It's got like 3,000, 2,000, 3,000 health at this stage in the game.
Yeah.
And that can be what they try to, continue the siege with. Right now they can rely on the Baron buff, but, they do have other options to try and push in.
Controlling those neutral objectives has been how Phoenix One have really sort of shown that growth as a team over the course of this split. And now they've got that Baron buff. Next Drake will be an Elder Dragon. Have you ever seen an Elder Dragon siege a turret?
I have not. I'm not sure if the ghost for the Elder Dragon is actually different because I haven't seen anyone play Mordekaiser since the Drake reworks. But that I'm very curious. I'm excited. I hope we get to find an answer to that question today.
Hopefully we'll find out. But as we can see, Immortal is still trying to fix out this problem. And Phoenix One taking a nice deep breath. And we've got to respect sort of the tactical worth of a pause like this, being able to slow the roll, like, okay, hold on, you've got the Mordekaiser, you've got the Baron right now.
I mean,
of course, this is not a tactical pause. This is a technical pause, but you've got to take a look at the mindset when something like this happens.
Yeah, I mean, they're not allowed to talk or anything, so it's, not really much is changing here. Maybe your heart rate slows back down, or I guess you get less caught up in the action, trying to think through your own plans, but
the adrenaline burns off.
Yeah, I think the plan here for Immortals is pretty clear, as they're going to try and stabilize right now. Their outer turret that's still staying in mid lane is definitely going to be forfeit. That thing has only got like 50 HP, so they just have to play a little safe, try and stall it out for a while, wait out that Baron buff, and see if they can hold on till that late game, because they do have a lot of late game power in a team fight if they are able to hold on for...
As long as they avoid the big bop, then they'll be fine.
Mm-hmm.
And with a lot of crowd control from that Viktor, CC from Lissandra, even a Crescendo to slow people down, might be a way to kill Inori before he can get to that back line. But Brandini has also been stepping up quite a bit. He really suffered during the laning phase, and in game one and game two, it was the exact same thing yesterday.
Yeah, I mean, it's so rough, right? The range melee matchup like that, especially when it is a control mage who's going to try and punish you on the side. But yeah, as we said, once you get the cowl and then you build into your spirit vision, so much sustain on the Trundle, and he has done a good job coming back in that split push.
Okay,
so there's no talking, but there is Rochambeau allowed. Who will be the champion?
And oh, Brandini's up.
Were you keeping track? I forgot. I didn't see the first
one. There we go.
I think Inori won the first one.
Zeke comes back. There it is.
It's best
up.
Of five, I assume. I guess that's two for.
Oh yeah,
things got spicy. You guys win for the
face.
Turn
there he
here
goes again.
That's it. You end on a stalemate, two rock?
Well.
Come on.
Bit of friendly rivalry.
Right? It's the personality of this team as well. It's not just the flavor of the picks in game. Like, Gate has been on this team from the very beginning.
Yeah.
And every time we interview him, he's just this big, bubbly, smiley guy who's always like, yeah, man, we're 0-8. It's no problem, though. Everybody's underestimating us. It'll be all good. We're great. We're going to come back into this. And look at that. He always has, faith. He's such an optimistic guy. There's so many, strong personalities on this team. It's just, I don't know, it's kind of uplifting to see them take games off of TSM and possibly Immortals here.
Mm-hmm. Well, we've got a few more minutes of pause coming up, so we're going to go ahead and toss over for some bonus coverage of Cloud9 versus Echo.
And at this point, standing way too close to things, they just can completely take him down.
AFO's so squishy, and it's this Gangplank just being so far behind. I mean, he would have been like maybe one more level, but it's still being blown up. Squishy build. Not able to actually put pressure on this Ezreal from Sneaky that's three levels up himself and has been getting a lot of that sideways farm. Talking about they put him in a side wave every time.
Always. There were pings on the side wave when they were actually taking that top inhibitor. It was crazy. Cloud9 knows what they need to do next. The curtain call comes down. Keith trying to stand his ground in the backside and the inhibitor turret onto Impact. The best person here for Cloud9. Everybody's taking the journey and the tether doesn't even lock. Meteos down. Could Smoothie be the first to fall? They still make it out alive. And Hart is going to go just that for Jensen. He gets on. Jensen throws down the Miasma Slow. And nobody can get to him. They turn around to try and fight this as Meteos goes back in as well. And they can't decide if they want to stop the fight or not. And Fox is in the same position.
Froggen really bold right now. Impact still doesn't take too much damage from him. But he'll get enough rotations off with the Rylai's. Gets him over the wall with the Shatter Dash.
Ridiculous. If it would have been Tim for the first guy to go down, that would have been even crazier. But here's this already. Cutlass at the end as well.
Of course, we just saw Cloud9 looking very good.
Yeah, I was just checking in. I'm pretty sure they've got everything cleaned up here. Just getting our last ready checks for this game, and we can jump back in.
Mm. And again, to restate this, Phoenix One just took the Baron against Immortals in game number one with that jungle Mordekaiser, AD carry Kalista, and we've gotten back in.
Right. What led up to this Baron, by the way, so P1, they had been trying to control both neutral objectives, the Baron and the Drake, pretty much the entire river, for the majority of the mid game, trying to bait over and over Immortals into a fight there where they were able to use the counter initiation. They finally got it at the Drake, the last Ocean Drake that we saw down there, and Phoenix One, having cleaned up that team fight afterwards, then transition into this Baron, are now trying to siege and convert it into gold.
Mm-hmm. Despite there being barely 200 health on that turret, five members of Immortals are grouped up to defend it. 252, but Brandini is blip pushing in another lane, and with teleport, Immortals have to give it up, as you said. Meanwhile, though, they continue to pressure forward with another minion wave. Brandini is going to get another tier 2 before Huni can respond. That's two turrets with that Baron, and it's still got about 3 minutes left.
Baron buff should be able to help them crack through here. Immortals, as we said, though, they have so much wave clear.
Oh, wow, ooh. Brandini. Really starting to put some harass onto Huni Knight right now.
Yeah, what he should do is clear that wave, then move over and just throw a pillar here to zone Immortals off. Guess the pillar is not even necessary, as they are able to take out the last.
Oh, boy.
You're going to shave off that newest millimeter of hair that just grew in the last week?
It's only been a week, man. How many haircuts can you take?
Also, don't be fooled. If you walk up to Dyrus and try and shave his head as some random person, Dyrus, while he's a very calm person and he looks a little sleepy,
he's a big dude.
Don't mess with Dyrus.
Alrighty, now Phoenix One setting up the Siege 4-1 split. That's Huni with the rest of his team. Five members of Immortals there, and Phoenix One trying to play it back, not to let themselves get caught. Brandini's working on the bottom inhibitor turret. Brings it down to half. Continuing to clear out this vision. Phoenix One still with the Baron buff, bringing those minions back in again. There's a good spell shield from Wild Turtle, but that turret is already chunked down to half, down to a quarter. Phoenix One, they've still got so much time. They are using this Baron buff so effectively.
Yeah, and they're making very quick work of actually both side lane turrets. Brandini still keeping up the pressure down there. Huni's actually rotated over. Maybe Immortals are going to pull the trigger here. Let's see. They have everything ready. Adrian's got the flash ready for Crescendo. And Huni has flash as well with Lissandra.
Oh, they've got a Gory on the side. Cosmic Radiance, but he's on you to stall it out. There's the Cosmic Radiance afterward. He's got Invuln and will stall it out despite the stun. There's the Chaos Storm. They're doing everything they can to kill Inori.
They're trying to buy time here. Phoenix One are just trying to survive in the 4v5. Brandini's got the turret. He's getting the inhibitor. Now they go for the regage on the... This is going to be two inhibitors for Phoenix One.
What? One inhibitor's gone down. The second one will fall. And Immortals are falling further and further behind. It's 11,000 gold for Phoenix One.
And the whole map is Phoenix One territory right now. All of the wards are timing out as we speak for Immortals. They have two inhibitors down on the side lanes. The time is running out for them. They have to make one of those hero stands inside their own base to survive this game.
Oh man, the fan count is shifting. 75% of folks now think that Phoenix One will be victorious here.
Elder Dragon goes to end it, please. 50 seconds left on that thing, and we will see Phoenix One head over to it. All they have to do is set up again those pink wards. They've got two extra in inventory. One's already down there by the dragon. If they set up the other two, then it's going to be a very risky maneuver from Immortals if they want to come contested. The side lanes will be pushing in. There's not a lot of time for Immortals, so they have to make a very quick decision and try to force something into this counter-initiation built team from Phoenix One that have the Taric ultimate to stall out. There's so many invulnerabilities here on Phoenix One, and it's going to take so long to kill them that if you stay outside your base for that long, the minions will do the work for Phoenix One.
Mm-hmm. 6 seconds left on that Elder Drake. Phoenix One, after having themselves a brief dance in the mid lane, rush down, trying to catch someone. Ori looks for Adrian. There's a flash crescendo, a huge bug, Cosmic Radiance. Will he survive? He will, and they continue to chase forward. They don't even need the dragon. Three members of Immortals are dead.
What do we say about that style here for Phoenix One? It's definitely here in spades, and they're going to head into the base to end it here. Three members down for Immortals. This would be a miracle stand if Fobelter could get back. Holy moly, game number one here for Phoenix One.
They are rushing forward. Huni gets into the back line and destroyed by Mash. 16-8. Gate will stall out Fobelter with a stun on top of it. The Nexus falls, and Phoenix One, the giant killers, take game one. Huge smiles from Phoenix One after that match. Oh, wow. Very well-deserved victory. And a very stoic face on Rainover.
Like, this is some fairy tale stuff, Dom. Inori, Phoenix One, they're actually insane. They're just picking Rengar, killing people. They take down TSM, number one team in the whole league. Nobody else has beat them. Then they come out with Mordekaiser jungle versus Immortals.
Exactly.
Surprise them with constant lane swapping back and forth. They had the first blood where Adrian face checked the bush. That was all planned. Mm. You know, great strategy there. And from there, they were able to snowball with so many of these Drakes and finally bait Immortals into that last one. That was the crucial fight with led to Baron and broke the whole thing wide open.
Phoenix One looking so strong, but the Phoenix One magic is back. 38 minutes will do it for game number one. But we're going to pass it over to the analysts to break that game down.